The other day on my way into town, my son was looking at me. He goes, Dad, I'm scared. It's good to be scared. You should be scared, son. You know, I'm scared too. But the fear is not the problem. It's what you do with it.
It's been tough. I mean, you know, we get used to doing things a certain way and living a certain way, and now we have to adjust to things completely different. We have to think ahead for, you know, bills and food and getting free lunch at school.
2.2 million Americans out of work. We're part of that. Because we're locked out by Rio Tinto, a company that makes billions and billions of dollars a year. Do they want to share with us? No.
Borax is mined from the earth as translucent crystals. For centuries, it's been used by humans in laundry soap and a lot more.
The main use for borax is in fiberglass, but it's used a lot in building materials. It's used in agriculture, used in one proportion as a fertilizer, then different proportion as a weed killer.
We use borates for high-definition TVs, your LCD screens. You find borates in your woods. They treat the wood for houses with borax to keep termites from chewing them. Pretty much anything that you have in your house has borax. This is the second largest open pit mine in the United States. And it's only one of two borax mines in the world. We have 570 workers out here at the Boron mine.
The workers' contract with management had been renegotiated every 3 to 5 years.
Our negotiations for this current contract started in September of 2009. And right from the beginning, you know, it was clear the company wanted to literally do away with 40 years of contract language.
The existing contract was known as the Green Book.
They put up the Green Book, and they referred to it as the Green Book, the 2004 contract, and they said, throw it away.
They said, we're throwing everything out. The contract's gone, all of that's gone, all your past practices are gone, all your grievance settlements are gone. Here's your new contract.
Then they took their package and they threw it on the table, just like that.
Their proposal will probably be 8 or 10 pages long, and basically it says, we can do whatever we want.
The contract that has existed here for years and continues to get more and more complicated doesn't work in a mining environment. The contract language we've proposed is common around America for mining facilities and works quite well.
They wanted a unilateral, absolute control of the employee. They wanted it on a daily basis. They wanted to be able to move the employee's wages up and down as they deem fit. They wanted the ability to hire in temporary workers with no limitations whatsoever. They wanted to contract out any job with no limitations whatsoever.
Under their proposal, they can put you anywhere they want. You have no say. They can put you on any shift that they want. They can put you on any days off that they want.
Remember, we're talking heavy industry. We're talking about skilled employees. It takes years to reach these levels of skill. It is literally abhorrent to treat such a workforce that way.
I have a lot of respect for veterans. Now, the company has taken this and have stricken all veterans' benefits out of our contract, all of them.
It was nothing like anything I've ever seen before or read about in negotiations except in the historical context.
Negotiations were extremely tense and very adversarial. We reached almost no agreements on any substantive issues, and the company demanded from the start and throughout complete and wholesale changes to virtually everything.
We try to do a good job for the company and ourselves, and we feel betrayed. We've had a contract for 40 years, and every negotiation we tweak it up or down, whatever, you know, work something out fair for both of us, and this time they just refused to negotiate.
We've been negotiating since September, and we just haven't had meaningful discussions with the union. They've only been willing to meet 2 days a week, and we're just not reaching any sort of agreements.
Yeah,
they wouldn't show up, and you know, we'd be waiting from like 8 o'clock till 1 p.m, and they'd be there from 1 till 1:15. And they just come in and say, we don't like your proposals, we're not telling you why.
The company never negotiated, ever. It was a take it or leave it offer. There were days in there that we went in, the two negotiating committees were only together for like 10 to 20 minutes.
The negotiations began in September of 2009. And continued until January 2010.
During that last week of negotiations in January, they said, look, either you ratify this or we're locking you out January 31st.
In a lockout, the plant's gate is closed to union members. If union members vote to reject Rio Tinto's offer, they will face an uncertain future.
Our local called an emergency union meeting for Saturday, January 30th.
Let's call this meeting to order. It's an illegal contract. I knew it was going to be bad, but I didn't know it was going to be this bad. We've been over, I think, 30 visits now. It doesn't take that long. It's just that they want their stuff in. They want a new contract. It's their contract. It's not ours. And there were some people that were pissed off. They wanted to go on strike, you know, right away. But, you know, our strategy was not to go on strike. Our strategy was to get a fair contract.
I want to make a motion that we reject this contract that the company has offered.
This contract that they wanted us to ratify.
Garbage.
There's not one thing in there that anybody on this committee or anybody in this room had anything to do with.
The company gives the impression that this big bad union is lying to the membership and not telling them what's going on and telling them what to do, and it's exactly the opposite. This is a democracy. I represent these people. They tell me what to do.
What the company's counting on is everybody's fear and insecurity. That's what they're counting on today. And you guys think about the fear and insecurity you have today. That's what you will have every day with this contract.
They told us yesterday they were going to release people who are working today to come to this meeting because they think, even today, that you all will take whatever they offer to avoid being locked out.
Okay, we got a motion on the floor. All those in favor of rejecting this contract, say aye.
Aye!
Those opposed, say nay.
What you're telling this committee is you don't want them to crawl back this afternoon to some hotel over in Palmdale and beg them for a contract.
Right.
After you told them that you're ready to take a lockout, when are you stronger, today or tomorrow?
Today.
We are. We're going to call them up and we're going to tell them that you rejected the damn contract. You're going to take the lockout and you're ready to bargain with them. But you're going to be stronger when you've shown them what your backbone looks like.
Right.
That's what you just voted on, brothers and sisters.
It's just the first round and it's going to get harder. And we have to stick together. So it's up to you.
After the workers were locked out, my law firm filed an unfair labor practice charge against the company with the United States National Labor Relations Board.
Local 30 faces one of the most formidable corporations in the world. Rio Tinto has mining operations all over the globe.
I started doing some research on the company to find out, okay, what are we up against? What have they done in the other contract negotiations recently? What I actually found kind of shocked me. We didn't know that this company had such a bad reputation all over the world.
Well, Rio Tinto's got a long track record of supporting deregulation and attempting to de-unionize its operations all around the world. And in the mid-1990s, it set about attempting to de-unionize its coal mines.
We're dealing with a company, Rio Tinto, who has an arrogance, an attitude.
They attempted to stall collective bargaining and under the new laws available to them, laws that they had a hand in drafting, offer individual contracts. The contracts were secret. The workers weren't allowed to discuss them with anybody, including their family. They were decapitating the local union lodges.
The workers united will never be defeated.
And the workers stuck together.
I cannot believe this morning the arrogance of Rio Tinto management.
And ultimately, the company failed. The union got a compensation deal back, a combination of money and jobs, and the total of the money was a record for Australia of $25 million. The mines now are 100% unionised.
The company's bad reputation didn't begin recently. It began decades ago.
There are a number of famous incidents over the previous decades. It goes right back to the Spanish Civil War when the Rio Tinto company then basically praised the Franco dictatorship for busting unions in Spain.
Rio Tinto collaborated with the dictator to use prisoners of war as slave labor in their mines.
The ores and mercury, which are for Franco Spain a rich source of foreign exchange.
There are so many companies that are looking and seeing if Rio Tinto gets away with this, then we can probably get away with it too. This is just a microcosm, a little example of what's going on all across the country. You know, this is where the battle's being fought right now.
I come from Australia, from the Maritime Union of Australia. We came over here to stand shoulder to shoulder with our brothers and sisters of the ILWU against this rotten company that sacked all these workers and locked them out.
We want work! We want work! We want work!
Come on down! Come on down!
We want work!
Behind me is U.S. Borax and hundreds of union workers who are being locked out after months of negotiations between the union and the company have gone nowhere.
Once again, they disrespected us, and we're just not going to tolerate it.
The lockout started Sunday at 7 a.m., but that didn't stop hundreds of employees from showing up to let Rio Tinto Minerals know they want to work.
I had never, in my 31 years of employment, never imagined that we would actually be locked out of our jobs. It was devastating to myself. I started to cry and it was very emotional, as were many of my coworkers.
Well, everybody know we made the front page of the Los Angeles Times this morning. Yeah. The world is listening. Yeah. Just want to let everybody know, keep your head up, stay strong, keep the faith, and keep fighting. That's what we're going to do, okay?
While the workers are locked out, the company hired temporary workers to take their place. And the jobs they'll be doing are not easy.
I ran a Laterno 1350 front-end loader. So my day was pretty much going down into the pit. I actually dig it out, load it up on a haul truck. The haul trucks take it up to our primary crusher. At the primary crusher, they'll dump it into a hopper in which it goes into these rollers and it's literally crushed down into smaller rocks.
Management is prepared to loosen safety regulations for these temporary workers.
They can get hurt pretty bad if they're not paid attention to the lights and the horns that goes off. There's horns in there to let you know where we got to boil up when you get a plug, and it can boil over on you. And at 250 Fahrenheit, when it gets hot, you can get burned pretty bad.
We get a lot of information from subcontractors going into the plant, supervisors working in there, you know, some of the security that works in there. They're very good about giving us information back. And what we have heard is the majority of their replacement workers are unskilled workers.
They brought in all this alleged expertise help.
Right.
The scabs.
The people we've brought in are skilled Americans from all over the U.S. that were currently unemployed, and they're happy to be here.
They can say whatever they want. They're not putting out very much product.
And I know for the first month, month and a half, there weren't any steams coming from any of the plants. So there was very little, if anything, getting done.
And we've had truck drivers stop and tell us, I'm empty coming out. Since the lockout, you know, a lot of us in the union have had to step up and take roles that normally we wouldn't do. So when the lockout came and they needed people, you know, I was there to step up.
The first day of the lockout, I actually hung around down here, and we had a big crowd down here, and they had sign-up sheets for everybody to sign up for gate duty. Our purpose for being out here at the gate really is to document anybody coming in and out these gates. When we have truck drivers coming in, you know, we let them know what's going on. We actually try to get them to turn around and take their loads back and not cross our line. So we have actually had cases where people have shown up out here and they knew nothing of, you know, our dispute with the company. And they've shown up and sat there and flat out said that they will not come back through. Oh, what's about to happen right now is we have one of the buses and the Gettier guards that haul the scabs in and out. They're getting ready to come out the gate right now. And what's gonna happen is the guys are lining up on the line that they've marked there at the gate.
It's an elaborate dance between the workers and the security guards hired by the company. The guards are constantly videotaping, searching for any infraction of the company's rules.
Wherever we go, they're trying to catch us doing something.
You're a sad individual, buddy. You're sad.
The security guards are from the Gettier Company.
This Gettier Company is a union-busting company. One of the things they do is they pretty much guarantee that they'll get an injunction against the picket lines. Okay, so they're out there with their video camera. We don't have picket lines. We don't carry picket signs. This is not a strike. This is a lockout.
What they will do is they will stop them and they will walk those vehicles all the way out here to our 45 sign.
Why do you do that?
To let them know we're out here, that they're going to have to deal with us every single day that they come out here.
These guys are hired to break unions, and it's about as un-American as you're gonna get.
Rio Tinto has a bad record everywhere in the world. Australia, developing nations, they're a terrible company.
Michigan's Upper Peninsula is a spectacular place. It's very undeveloped, so there's a lot of large tracts of undeveloped wild lands left. A lot of people come to this region to just get away from the hectic chaos that more developed areas have to offer them.
We were noticing a lot of drilling rigs up on the plains, a lot of trucks rolling around. You started seeing the airplanes flying over. So this was Kennecott Exploration, which is a subsidiary of Rio Tinto. Sulfide mining, it's called hard rock mining, and immediately upon air and water coming into contact with these sulfides, it starts creating sulfuric acid.
Kennecott was proposing to mine under the Yellow Dog River and the Salmon Trout River.
There are releases that they did not attend that get into the groundwater that go into the Salmon Trout River, then eventually getting into the Lake Superior.
Rio Tinto started building on our public land prior to having all of their permits.
Stand up for clean water! Stand for Kennecott's illegal occupation out of Eagle Rock!
People of that community started asking questions of their local officials, attending public hearings. A number of local people, both non-Indigenous and Indigenous people, took over that proposed mine site and camped out on the portal for 5 or 6 weeks.
This is an important stand here with this group of people that's out here. The water's full of contaminants, the land is contaminated, the air. You can have all that money in the world, but when it comes to growing food, how are you going to keep on living with that kind of environment?
Kennecott's been in here and intimidating people. Today we got a message that the police were on their way.
Rio Tinto doesn't care about communities. They don't care what happens along the route. They really don't care about that as long as they're able to get their mine in place.
The lockout, literally a company's intent is to starve the workforce, starve them economically, to terrorize them with, you know, the absolute fear of the unknown. How am I going to provide for a mortgage? How am I going to provide for medicine? How am I going to put food on the table? How am I going to pay my bills? So we ended up setting up an array of committees.
When the trucks come in with loads of food, you know, we're there to help stock it.
Right. Yeah, let me get the canned goods. Every day, Monday through Friday, we give out food to our members. We come in here and we make sure they have food so their kids.
We show up, you know, down there once a week for meetings. We show up to distribute the food, doing 2, sometimes 3, 4-hour shifts. We stay after everybody else leaves to, you know, get it all set up.
We have lockout meals. A lockout meal is when all the food is free, that's a lockout meal.
And it came from the AFL-CIO, yeah. Then we call it our lockout meal.
One thing that the union did, which was an unbelievable help to all of us, was the financial aid system that they set up, doing fundraisers through LA.
So we have to pay back the months that we didn't pay?
There are no promises that we can make, but we're going to look at everybody's individual need and then go from there.
He's got a sign here, right?
He's got a sign here. Yeah. Are you or any of you?
A lot of families in this area are having to make drastic changes, you know. People are already having phones turned off, you know.
It has to be started or you don't get it.
Trying to defer payments. So every little bit right now helps.
Number one, we should be concerned about people's medical and maintaining medical, particularly those people in crisis and in real need.
And my daddy took me to the birthday party and I got this ring. I tried to hit the pinata.
Tori, our grandbaby, she was born with a severe heart murmur and needs ongoing medical care. So we definitely needed the medical insurance for her to make sure that her appointments were met, her EKGs, her sonogram, everything was taken care of. And they did pay for that. They took care of it all.
Number two, the question of being able to keep people in their homes.
We worried about making every house payment and we held off as long as we could each time. The company kept stringing us along and kept making it look like we might get a contract, but then if we didn't, we had to figure out whether we were gonna make the next house payment.
The Union Emergency Committee came through very, especially last month, because we had to move from our previous residence and had to move to something a little more affordable. And I went to my union, I had to suck it up, being kind of a prideful person, I sucked it up and went in there and asked for help. And without hesitation, we have you, we can take you. Is there anything else we can do for you? We came back that day and we had a smile on our face, all right? Local 30, ILWU came through for me and my family.
And all the money, you have to pay it all back. The information.
After we interview each person, we then sit down collectively with the three teams that are here to review each application, and then we make a decision based on those criteria.
So right now you're doing okay, just your COBRA.
Right. Yeah, I'm actually doing okay.
We want to work! We want to work! We want to work!
A lot of the workers that have been in there all day are coming out. These are the workers, the replacement workers that are working in our guys' place.
You stop, keep going.
Go back to work, slow down.
Todd,
back to the table.
Tired of it. Let us go do it. We know the bucket will.
So how's it feel trying to do a real American job, huh? We want to work.
We had just built a house a couple years back, and, you know, it's rough having the kids wondering, are we going to lose our house? You know, stuff like that. I mean, I hate seeing my kids all stressed out like this, you know? And you can't lie to them. My son here, his big thing was, yeah, my dad drives the train for U.S. Borax. And now he's stuck out here on the line screaming for people to try and give our jobs back.
You see these kids? These are my kids. I work my ass off for these kids.
We can't feed our kids because of you.
This is the 104th day of a strike by workers at the U.S. Borax mine in Boron, California.
The last 4.5 months, where I was 23, 24 years old. Very unorganized. No one knew what they were doing compared to this lockout.
Arrests occur almost daily. And several buildings at the mine have been burned. The hardware store's windows were smashed and are now boarded up. Violence is common.
Things have changed. We didn't even carry picket signs this time. We wanted to look like we were decent people to the public. We want to be perceived as people that had a plan.
Hi, Linda. How are you?
Hi, how are you?
Oh, I'm doing all right, all things considered. I have been volunteered to be on the outreach committee to go ask some of our business owners. Outside of paying union dues, I hadn't had much involvement because there was not really a need. But now I decided that whatever I could do to help our cause as a union to get back to the bargaining table, to get these issues resolved, that's what I wanted to do. So I became part of the outreach committee, trying to get the message out that we do want to go back to work.
The heart of this community lives here, and consequently, the people that are working now inside, they're torn because they also have family locked out, as well as family inside the plant. So it's a very emotional thing, and of course, when people are without insurance and without jobs, you wouldn't expect them to be in the best mood all the time.
Especially in the beginning, there's just so much anger and, excuse me. in the beginning, there's just so much anger, but we've tried to work through that and have faith and, you know, tried to have a Christ-like attitude.
There are some people that go to church with us who are temporary workers, and it's been really hard to go to church and to see them, but on the same coin, I would rather see them coming to church and trying to do what's right in their lives than to treat them bad. So Tyler and I are not willing to treat people ugly in the face of this.
Don't know that much about the contracts and things, but for the little communities, your business did gradually decrease. So had to subsidize a little bit to keep everything running as it was. He took things out to the line for him. Just tried to give him moral support, actually. You know, they're family.
It's important to me to support the community and support the other people. My father-in-law and my father have both worked for the company for years.
We believe that there is power in numbers, and that the unions have always been the strength of America.
Rio Tinto spent a lot of money every month on full-page ads in a lot of our local newspapers, trying to boost their standing with the community, trying to show what a nice guy they are. So ILWU Local 30, we started our own media campaign.
We've got a lot of media coverage that's come in, so why don't we review our media coverage?
We had magazine articles in These Times and The Nation, and I also spoke on NPR's The Marketplace radio and appeared on Democracy Now!
There were some of the folks that were talking to some of the local clergymen and also some that were talking to the local politicians and trying to, you know, explain to them what our situation was.
We have a newsletter called the Sagebrush Telegraph. It's the unofficial newsletter for the ILWU Local 30 locked out workers.
We just started writing articles. We had suggestions from different members of what they wanted to know about. Some of the folks were concerned about how they were going to pay for their prescriptions, and we did some research and found that there was different ways they could get cheap prescription drugs.
And I think the majority of us was July.
We also went to speak at college campuses.
And very pleased today, able to bring down the three members of Local 30, of the Longshore Workers Union.
They wanted to be able to lay off anybody at any time in any order. Right now they have to go by seniority.
So that night before I called my supervisor, I don't feel safe. You know, it's getting dark, I can't see it, I'm not loading now. They pulled me out of the area.
You know, having the internet was really great for communication. People on Facebook were taking pictures of all of our local businesses that would have the support signs.
That's when we decided everybody needed the information. My idea was to get a couple people together and start a website so that everybody can get the same information and everybody would know what was going on. Boraxminers.com. We would put action bulletins that we would get from the International Union every week, and we would post those so everybody can see what was going on during negotiations.
We had quite a lot of people from other unions in Canada, Australia. They all heard about the website, they found the Facebook page somehow. That was an avenue for people to vent, to share information, and that information sharing made things go a lot better and made us a lot stronger in fighting this too.
Friends of Local 30 from all over the world posted stories on YouTube.
Going to their workers in California and saying, you have two choices. You can cut your wages, cut your benefits, cut your holidays, tear up your collective agreement, or we're going to lock you out and bring scabs in.
Rio Tinto, you're no good!
We would also post information about Rio Tinto.
A lot of these people, you know, they were like third generation miners. They had no idea about this company. some of the stuff we would find was shocking.
The majority of bougainvilleans, they do palming, palm for cash crop like cocoa and coconut.
A tropical paradise with one misfortune, major natural resources.
There was around 900 million tons of copper ore, which also contained gold. Rio Tinto discovered the copper and the gold and decided that anything that was about a foot underneath the ground was theirs. And of course, when they discovered that, they were definitely going to mine it out without giving any consideration to the people of Bougainville or the environment. It's a matrilineal society. Ownership is by the women, and the land is passed down to the daughters and the granddaughters for a long, long time. The women and their babies oppose the mine from the very word go.
Before reaching the final layers of overburden, they cleared 550 acres of jungle and sluiced away the unconsolidated rock and ash.
They forced their way into the people. Like when the woman landowners were protesting, they kicked them and they dragged them along the beach and they threw them in the hole or something, so they forced their way into it.
Even though the people of Bougainville own their land, they don't seem to have much control over it, so to speak, when it comes to multinational mining companies like Rio Tinto. It's disgusting what they've done to the environment, and don't seem to have any regret, the mining company, for doing that.
You know, destroy the mountains, everything, and it just start digging a big hole.
The construction workers employed by Rio Tinto Mining Company came from Australia, 9,000 workers, not Bougainvillean people. Not one Bougainvillean person was employed.
Our color is black. There are only a few educated ones work in the mining, work at the mine site or mine, the company.
The people in Bougainville weren't even offered an equity share. The landowners got a smidgen, a tiny fraction of money compared to the billions that the mining company Rio Tinto were making. So the people mobilised and tried peacefully, you know, to speak to the mining company by having meetings with them.
But Rio Tinto's officials refused to negotiate, insisting that their mining operations had no impact on the life of the people.
And one particular character, Mr. Francis Ona, took some dynamite from the mine and decided to blow up the electric pylon. And they succeeded in knocking over, I think, two or three of those pylons, and that stopped the mine from operating.
Yeah, Papua New Guinea government, they respond very quickly with sending the right police with order shoot to kill. They said, do anything to open the mine back.
From that, the Papua New Guinea Defence Force were called in.
The army received special assistance from Rio Tinto.
The company, you know, gave them the trucks and money and helicopter, the commercial helicopter, which are owned by company. They use it. They started spraying villages from that helicopter. Bougainvilleans, they stood together. From north to south, we stood up and we started, you know, defending our land.
The Bougainville Revolutionary Army was formed and a war began.
The mine finally shut down in 1989, in May.
The military blockade by land, sea, and air lasted 9 more years and caused misery to the people. No medicines could get through, and there was a shortage of food.
And it caused a lot of, you know, deaths on Bougainville, maybe 15,000 to 20,000 lives lost.
The charges of the lawsuit right now that are surviving are that Rio Tinto committed what are called war crimes and crimes against humanity and racially discriminated.
To your families, thank you for helping us make this stand.
Two of these trucks are full of food that were loaded on the tank to the workers in Boron.
Folks are making the trip from here in Dodger Stadium up to help the families in Boron. The spirit and the passion that the workers have shown in standing up to the greed in corporate America is something that's resonating with people throughout the Southland.
They're locking out our brothers and sisters up in Boron, and we're going to support them to show that they have support here in Los Angeles.
ILWU has flown us here today for this shareholders meeting with Rio Tinto, so I can go up and ask them a question about why are they treating their workers this way.
I haven't heard any complaints about their treatment of the workers. I should be interested to see if anyone does, in fact, mention any objections.
We're here to show that Rio Tinto have locked the mine, so there are loads of families without any jobs and there are people starving in Boron.
The ILWU in California has got shares, and they're going into the meeting. Two of them are going into the meeting to as shareholders to raise their issues.
Perhaps I can start by saying to you all good morning, and I'm very pleased to welcome you to this year's annual general meeting.
Yeah. Thank you. I come from Boron, California. My name's Dave Irish. I work at the Rio Tinto U.S. Borax Mine. Tom, you mentioned one thing about seniority. You didn't talk about the other proposals that you want to take away full-time jobs and turn them into part-time employment spots. You also didn't talk about if an employee gets injured and is out on disability, how you want to take away the health benefits to their families. And you blame the union for not coming to the contract table, which is wrong. The company hadn't met with us one time since they locked us out January 31st. What we came here today is to see why you disrespect the employees, some with 40 years of experience at the mine, dedicated employees to U.S. Borax, Rio Tinto Minerals. Is that important to you?
None of the proposals that are being discussed and anybody designed to create a number of temporary positions. We are simply suggesting flexibility, as Tom has already previously indicated.
As you can tell, they avoided answering my questions that I had. And some of the things that they did discuss, like taking away full-time jobs, you know, they want flexibility. Well, what is flexibility? You know, we're working class people here. This is a, you know, first-rate organization that, you know, that the union works for. And the union makes it that way. We make it safe, and they want flexibility. We don't understand what they want.
What do we want?
Justice!
When do we want it?
Now!
I think Rio Tinto is deplorable. I think this is classic Rio Tinto. Rio Tinto got $720 million in stimulus money from the United States government, and they've locked out workers in California, forcing them on public assistance.
While we were in London, the union organized a demonstration at the LA British consulate.
The British government should take a position and tell the UK-based Rio Tinto Corporation, don't try to starve out families, put them back to work. Those workers want to work, and you can't use economic terrorism on workers who just want to support their families.
We have to support our workers and support our working families. Otherwise, they can't make it.
It's a corporation that in the first 6 months of 2010 have already made $5.8 billion.
The president of Rio Tinto made more last year than all of our workers combined. We are not asking for more. We are just asking for fair treatment and to be able to raise our families.
Meanwhile, the lockout heads into its fourth month.
My daddy doesn't work anymore.
How come?
Because they took our job. Yeah.
And,
is that gas?
Yeah, this is gas. This is 60, actually 61. Let's just round it up.
What's that?
Eligibility. We got turned down for Medi-Cal.
We at this point have no health insurance. We just got a statement saying that we've been turned down for Medi-Cal. I'll have to call tomorrow and see,
what the heck is up with that.
Why we don't have any health insurance. It's a hard thing when you have three children. We just want to be able to live. I don't want nothing fancy. I just want to be able to pay my bills and provide for my children.
I got to get out.
Go now, you guys can swing.
I've already looked for work out of state, and if we don't go back to work soon, we'll probably move out of state. So that's the plan right now. Stick it out as long as we can, and if we don't have a good resolution, then we're going to have to pack it up and move on.
And that's a hard thought, because we both grew up here, and our families, our aunts and uncles, and we both come from large families, and our siblings are nearby, our nieces and nephews, and we're very close as families. And it'd be really hard to have to pack up and move. And, you know, what do you do with your house? You know, if everybody's moving out of state because this job here isn't working out and it's a small community and everybody's having to move, what on earth are we supposed to do with our homes? You know, the market's already dropped a lot in California, and if this were to happen, it would really, really tear up this community.
Family is the only thing that matters at all, and we've said this to each other. They can take away our income, but they can't take away our family. We can pick up, we can move, we'll miss our house, we'll miss our friends, but if we have our family, they can't take that from us.
Negotiations were difficult because the Rio Tinto team would show up and then leave after 10 to 20 minutes.
Just a form of economic terrorism by the company. That's all this is, psychological warfare.
And they say, you know, in the paper, they have somebody write in there that they're always here waiting for us, and they're never there. We're always in the room sitting there.
Apparently now the company doesn't want to come into the room. You know, you need to come in and talk to the whole negotiating committee with the people who have a right, the workers have a right to be there to listen.
We waited. 3 o'clock, we sent the federal mediator in, tried to coax them out. What it basically amounted to was no progress this afternoon. They're afraid to face us.
But eventually it was decided that the union negotiating team would have to meet with Rio Tinto executives without the workers present.
Approximately 3 months after the lockout, a meeting occurred between the international ILWU president and one of the vice presidents of Rio Tinto. What occurred during that meeting was to make Rio Tinto aware that the International had the option to not handle any scab cargo, so close down the docks. None of Rio Tinto stuff and move out of the West Coast. And shortly thereafter is when they actually started to negotiate.
And there were other reasons, too, for Rio Tinto's sudden cooperation.
They needed us back at work. They needed the skilled workers back in there, the people who know how to run the plant.
From what I've understood since, if they're out of product out there at this point, that they were simply not being able to keep up with the orders that they had.
They knew that we had them for the illegal lockout. So that was one factor that brought them back to the table was our lawsuit.
The company realized that they were not going to be able to win.
We ended up generating a tentative agreement between the basic rights of the worker, okay, and the company's supposed problems or issues that they had. We brought that tentative agreement to the body.
I know we kind of ran into this already, but I got to be absolutely for sure on this.
And we actually presented copies of the tentative agreement so they could review them. The body was able to ask questions, get all their questions answered.
They're saying that they're going to give us 3 days layoff.
And it's a mass layoff and the Warren Act would apply.
The union victory was not without its compromises.
So pension is where the loss is. Folks should understand, pension for everybody here stays the same. Huge fight to get that. But what we gave up was for new hires aren't going to get your pension plan. New hires are going to get a defined contribution plan, like a 401k plan. I'll tell you that the committee really worked hard here. And this was, folks really thought that this was the best deal that we were going to get. People are proud of it. You guys should be proud of your committee because they fought like hell for it.
As you know, this green book, we always refer to it as green book. The company just trashed it. And I will tell you today that most of the green book is back.
Rio Tinto did not want this meeting to happen because Rio Tinto is coming after everybody. But you guys stood up and now you've set the scale, you set the bar. This is a huge victory for the ILWU. It's a huge victory for the labor movement in the country and around the world.
Let's clear the room so we can get set up for voting. Thank you.
From what I've seen, it looks fairly reasonable, so we'll see what happens. I have a feeling that it's gonna pass. The beauty of the democratic process will manifest itself here today.
I know there's people, you know, they wanted more, they didn't get it, but I look at it this way. We didn't lose anything, and I'm happy with it.
I think we gave up too much for it for me to personally pass through. My father was union president during the 80s on this. He's the one that fought for it to get a guaranteed pension where seniority mattered stuff, and we're just giving too much away.
Look at it from our side. We're ready to go back to work. You know, we've been going on and on and on, and everybody's been hearing about, you know, the company's proposal. Well, what about the union's proposal? We're just going to break even. Yes, 95 no, 75% it passed. Woo-hoo!
You want some pins?
You know, and it was all this build up, and then about 5:30, the vote came in, and we have our contract, and was like, oh my gosh, it's, you know, it's over. The lockout's over, you know? The town of Boron, for the high school there, we've always been the little team, the little school that we've always had to fight. I don't think they realize what a fighting mentality we have.
A lot of us have always looked at unions as an organization that may be obsolete, but I gotta tell you, when you're dealing with a worldwide conglomerate like Rio Tinto, you learn to realize that unions aren't obsolete and we need them.
We all knew going back to work, nothing was going to be the same. There was a lot to overcome, and there was a lot of hostility still being vented, both on the side of the union and on the side of management.
They have hired some of the scabs back in, and I have my feelings about it, and they're not good, but at the same time, being a steward and also being a member of the executive board with the local, we need to do everything we can to bring these people into the fold.
And we're going to show them the union way. There's many issues that we're trying to, that they're going to benefit from the contract. Hopefully that they'll see why we fought out there for 4 months. But we have already filed at least 7 grievances in this contract alone. We have only been back there less than 2 months.
Everybody needs to understand, walking back into that plant, resuming our jobs, that's just step one in the next battle.
If it had not been for the support and the help of all the other unions that came forward and brought food and donated money and gave the support emotionally, that this could not have happened. And I think the guys got a great deal. And I think without the support of the International and without the support of all the other unions, the teachers union, the carpenters, the plumbers, the railroad workers, everybody that came, it was phenomenal. And that for me was the best part of the whole thing.
And I hope this causes a huge, I don't even know how to say it, that other company, other unions, other people that maybe aren't even in unions start rising against the big corporations, and that they go out and they fight and realize that they have a voice. That, yeah, it's hard to live without that paycheck, but you know what? It's worth it, and the pride you feel is so incredible.
They thought they could starve us out, but they didn't realize that they were dealing with, you know, a bunch of desert rat Davids that were really, really a lot tougher than they thought.